series. October 1st is observed as the International Day for Older Persons, and 2020 itself, 2020 to 30, is the decade of healthy aging. And on this line, we are our panel discussion is around the topic of holistic care towards healthy aging. In the panel, we have today Professor Sriram Varambali from Department of Psychiatry. He's currently the officer in charge at NIMHANS Integrated Center for Yoga. His research interests include neurobiology of psychiatric disorders and therapeutic use of yoga in neuropsychiatric disorders, with notable contributions in these areas. The second panelist is Dr. Kishore Kumar Ramakrishnan. He's the assistant professor of Ayurveda, Department of Integrated Medicine at NIMHANS Bangalore. The third panelist with us is our Dr. P.T. Shivakumar, sir. He is the professor from Department of Psychiatry, Geriatric Clinic and Services. He's also the coordinator of Biomanasa Sanjeevani Initiative. I welcome you all to the panel discussion, sir. We have Dr. Hemant. He is the assistant professor of yoga in Department of Integrative Medicine. Sir is the moderator for today's session. Before we go into today's session, we have a couple of announcements. One thing is the certificates for previous session, we have circulated to some, quite a few are pending. We'll circulate it within the next few days. The feedback link for today's session, if you would like to take the participant certification, kindly fill the feedback form, which will be shared in the chat box in YouTube as well as in Zoom. We'll get back to you on that shortly. If you have any queries to any panelists, please drop your concerns in the chat box. It will be answered in today's session. We'll try to cover most of the questions. If it is not possible, we'll get back in touch with you via email. And regarding the workshop for lay counselors, we'll be starting the first batch on 12th of this month, that is from next Monday onwards. Whoever is in the batch, we'll communicate to you personally via chat, via email. The remaining members, we'll keep having batch by batch. So we will communicate to you shortly. So let's start the session for today. I ask Dr. Hemant to take charge of the session, sir.
Thank you, Lakshmi. I welcome you all for this webinar series organized by Vayo Manasa Initiative, Sanjeevani Initiative. In this webinar series, which is titled as The Holistic Approach Towards Healthy Aging, we have experts from the domain of psychiatry, yoga, and Ayurveda, and we are going to have some useful discussions on these themes. So first, I would like to start with Dr. Sivaram Varampalli, who is the professor of psychiatry and the head of the Department of Integrative Medicine. Sir, when we talk about the holistic approaches in healthy aging, what is your take on this need for holistic medicine when we talk about healthy aging, sir?
The basic concept, what we have always sort of, although we talk about being healthy, when you look at the health system is primarily geared to treat people who are ill. We don't go to a doctor and ask a doctor, how do I stay healthy? That concept somehow has never been there, at least in the conventional system of medicine. Whereas if you look at the Ayurveda or other holistic forms of healthcare, that itself is a very significant branch which the doctor is supposed to handle. How to keep people healthy? Now, somehow this in the focus of identifying infectious disorders and various problems, we have lost that focus of how to be healthy and how to age gracefully and healthy. That focus has been lost. That is why I think we need to take the holistic viewpoint. I mean, I come from a background of modern medicine. I am very well aware that the achievements of modern medicine in terms of handling infectious diseases and, say for example, heart attacks, other things are tremendous and unparalleled. But for most people who are reasonably healthy, what is it that we offer? That question has never been really looked at. And therefore, I think we need to integrate the systems which look at health care rather than disorder care.
Yes, sir. Sir, when we talk about this holistic approaches, as you aptly said, that there is a need not only to take care of the medical illnesses, but there are the holistic approaches which also address the mental health aspects. So, what do you think? How much is the importance of mental health when we talk about healthy aging? What is the importance of mental health in that?
I mean, I think it is the most important thing, because no matter how healthy you are physically, if you are mentally, as you can see with people, you know, recent focus on suicide and other things, doesn't really matter if you have all the money in the world and if you are otherwise young and healthy. If you are mentally not well, it can lead you down to a path of depression and suicide, you know, which is such a waste of a life. Because, you know, already we have so many things that are conspiring to make us less healthy. You know, there is pollution, there is infection, there are so many things. And if we do not take care of our mental health, you know, that can be the most important reason for us not being healthy in spite of having everything else, you know. So I think mental health, as they, you know, from the time of Epictetus, it has been said that, you know, unless you are mentally healthy, overall health cannot be there. You know, they say a healthy mind can only be there in a healthy body, and vice versa. So I think mental health is a little bit neglected simply because we cannot see the problem from the outside. If you look at somebody and the person looks reasonably physically fit, we tend to assume that they are mentally fit as well, which may not be the case because we simply can't see the brain. Even if we do an MRI, we cannot see the brain whether it is healthy or not. So how do we make out just by looking at the person? I think it's a very neglected part of health. And this is the only way you can actually say, for example, somebody who has cancer, you know, but if they are mentally very strong, that life that they live even with cancer can be fulfilling. Whereas a person who is otherwise healthy, if they are mentally not healthy, they are unable to actually do anything. So the mental attitude is the most important thing which distinguishes a person who is able to manage his or her life well from a person who is not able to do it.
Thank you, sir. Now I would like to ask Dr. Kishore. Sir, from the ancient medicine perspective, when we look at the sciences of yoga and Ayurveda, are there any prescriptions for a healthy aging in ancient texts?
Thank you, Dr. Hemant, for the question. Yes. Now, speaking about aging, Ayurveda as a science has been divided into 8 branches. So, among them, Kaya Chikitsa, pediatrics, there are many. And one of the branch is known as Rasayana and Vajikara. Now, Rasayana is one such branch that has been proposed for healthy aging. Now, the basic aim of Rasayana is to see that the tissues in the body or the functions of the body are prioritized or are made to function more efficiently, and there are measures where this can be done. And it has been said that the Rasayana Chikitsa is a measure where you, through certain interventions, it's not only that lifestyle is given, but also people are made to undergo certain procedures like Panchakarma and take some, you know, rejuvenating tonics for a long period of time is done. And then it is also said that a healthy aging is achievable only when it is intervened at Purve Vayasi Madhyeva. That is, initially during youth and during middle age, you need to start thinking about healthy aging. Only then the aging will be healthy, because the capacity for rejuvenation and nourishment in in the younger age or in the middle age is much better because Agni, that is digestive capacity and metabolic capacity, is much better. So the excellence of tissues can be achieved through interventions during that age. So this has been told, and this branch of Ayurveda Rasayana deals with healthy aging. Now, healthy aging, there are various principles. One is that you follow Swasthavritta, that is all the principles for prevention, and then also some intervention. Now, for preventive measures, there are various prescriptions of Dinacharya, that is what all the regimen that you have to follow in a particular day, and Rutucharya, that is as per the different seasonal seasons, the regimen should be to be followed. These are the two main aspects which constitute for a healthy living. So basically, the Ayurveda, the prayojana of Ayurveda, Charaka says, swasthasya swasthya rakshanam, then aturasya roganut. That is, swasthasya, the protect the or promote or preserve the health of a person, and then the second objective is then treatment of various disorders. So initial prescriptions have been told how to lead a healthy life, not only in terms of food and lifestyle, but also in terms of following certain way of life in terms of mind. Nityam hita ahara vihara sevi samikshakari visheshu asaktah. Nityam hita ahara vihara is to follow good food, healthy food and behavior. Samikshakari is be very careful, be very watchful. Visheshu asaktah is not to get yourself addicted to or indulge yourself in certain things or overindulge. Samikshakari visheshu asaktah. Data samaha. Data samaha is be very generous and look upon every being as equal and own. Satyaha paraha, be very truthful. Kshamavan. Kshamavan is one who is always forgiving. And aptopasevi, be always in the good company of others. When you do these, it says that it also, so the aspect of mental health, how to prevent mental health, mental vulnerabilities, is to control the rajas and tamas. So three aspects: ahara, the food; vihara is behavior, how behavior, and then how to control the emotions through maintaining certain attitudes towards oneself and society. So these have been told as a dictum for maintenance of healthy. Bhavati arogaha, and this is a person who will be aroga. And a person who can achieve this in the initial phases will remain to be healthy during aging also. So these are the principles of how Ayurveda looks at aging. It very conspicuously mentions that aging is something which we have to think about when we are young. So from the beginning, try to do all these things so that your aging is uneventful and healthy.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much for your valuable inputs. We also have Dr. P.T. Shivakumar with us, who is a professor of psychiatry, especially in the area of geriatric psychiatry. I welcome you, sir. I would like to ask you a question here. When we talk about the healthy aging, definitely it emphasizes more on the preventive aspects of the health. So here, how do you think that the holistic approaches may contribute?
Thanks, Hemant. I think the overall target towards healthy aging is to promoting good health and then actually ensure good amount of functioning, because aging is associated with many chronic health conditions, including mental health problems. They may have say conditions like diabetes, hypertension, osteoarthritis, heart diseases. All these things have some amount of impairment in physical capacity. With aging, some normal changes in cognition happens, and sometimes they may have some sleep disturbances and subsyndromal depressive symptoms. All these things contributes to some amount of effect on negative effect on mental capacity. Healthy aging primarily is about improving the functional ability by ensuring that despite these limitations in mental capacity or physical capacity, by providing adequate support system, you can ensure healthy aging by improving the functional capacity, well, ability. And also some of the interventions can improve the intrinsic capacity, like either the cognition or the physical capacity or the mental capacity. We can promote it over a period of time. There is a good amount of evidence for that. So here, the holistic approach is very, very important. There is no magic pill. There is no magic treatment in allopathy or any other systems which can claim that they can actually be a panacea for all the problems. And what we see in our practice is elderly actually go through many of these systems. They explore whether the allopathic physician recommends it or not. Many of the senior citizens explore multiple forms of treatment either by themselves or based on reference, based on information from multiple sources. I think it is a good practice to get benefits from every system in a proper manner, in a coordinated manner, in a proper authentic sources. What we also see is many times people end up trying a lot of things which are not authenticated or which are not given by a proper qualified person, and then one system doesn't know what the other person is doing. This integration doesn't happen. So that is why we should talk about holistic approach, where there should be crosstalk between different systems of medicine and see how healthy practices can be done in a coordinated manner, whether it is the yoga, whether it is Ayurveda, whether it is health medicine. Sometimes people think say one can actually be a solution for everything, and they suddenly stop all the medications. There may be practitioner who say that, okay, depression can be treated by yoga, you stop all the medicines, and that may not be suitable for that individual person. So it has to be taken into consideration, and then say with a discussion, with a proper evaluation, these things should be advised. And when we talk of healthy aging, there is a lot of scope for integrative practices and holistic practices. And already people are using it. I think it is more required to kind of bring in some kind of synergy and some kind of integrative approach. And that's what NIMHANS is doing now, with having an opportunity for allopathic physician, a psychiatrist, and the yoga specialist and Ayurvedic specialist sitting in one platform, and then where for an individual person, these things can be discussed and then see as to what can be used and then provided in a coordinated manner. I think that kind of approach, the technology now allows to use even tele, and then have these consultations and do it in a very safe manner. And that's what we would wish. And each one should respect each other's limitations, each other's capabilities. They should know the strengths and weakness and do it in an integrated manner, wherever it is possible.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. As you spoke about the coordination of different systems of medicine together, where the traditional systems come with the modern medicine, I would like to ask Dr. Shivarama Varamparli, who is the head of the Department of Integrative Medicine. Sir, what is your experience in this coordination of different systems of medicine together towards patient healthcare?
I mean, it is not entirely a new concept. This has been the ideal from the time, immemorial. Even in the earliest Ayurveda texts, they say that knowledge should come from all sides and not be from one system. And one system of medicine cannot really offer a complete solution to all the health problems. It is written in the basic Ayurveda text itself. Therefore, this concept has always been recognized. How to implement it, like most of our rules and regulations, making the rules and regulations are very easy. How to implement it is a very tough thing. So various approaches have been tried. Say, for example, some private setups have what we call as co-location of systems. Say, for example, there is an allopathic doctor sitting in one room, there is an Ayurvedic doctor sitting in the next room, and there could be a yoga person sitting in the third room. This is good, but then is it ideal? May not be so, simply because all the people, you know, you have, for a patient or a person who has to consult, he has to have three consults. Now, this is not fair on the person who is trying to consult. You know, you want to get the Ayurvedic viewpoint also and the yoga viewpoint also. Person cannot be expected to go and meet three people at three different times. You know, it's going to be very complicated. So the only really practical model of integration has to be that you, if you remember the earliest general physicians that we had, you know, the people who worked in the 50s and 60s, the integrated, what used to be called as the integrated system of medicine at that time, they were aware of all these kind of treatments, you know, whether it is allopathic, some herbal treatments, Ayurveda, and all those things. And they would give a comprehensive picture to the patient. Say, simplest, for example, is the importance of diet and sleep. So many patients in our allopathic clinics ask, okay, you have given me medicine for this. Should I eat this? Should I eat that? Should I not eat this? And many of us don't know the answer. We say, okay, you know, I don't know whether it will really affect you. Make sure you take the medicine. But they are, in fact, in Indian system, it is ingrained what we, you know, patya, what we call as patya, that for a particular illness, this should not be done. You should not eat too much of sour thing, spicy thing. So this is, in fact, patients often know more than us. And they ask us, and we seem to be ignorant sometimes. So it's a good idea for integration to be happening. Say, for example, the doctor who is being trained, say a resident in IMHANS, if he or she is able to gather all the information from all these sources, a modern medicine person, an Ayurveda person, yoga person, going forward, this person who is being trained will be able to give a reasonable idea of all these approaches. I see that as the real integration. Of course, it's not very easy to do, but this is what has to be done. The other approaches really have not worked out to the benefit of the patient or the consumer, which is what we need to look at. That is what I think should happen.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, when we talk about healthy aging, especially in today's time, we know these COVID times, stress is playing a very, very, you know, detrimental role in affecting this quality of health and quality of mind. So I would like to ask Shivram sir about what is stress and how can we tackle with it?
I mean, stress is a very big topic by itself. But to put it very simply, I usually say stress is an abbreviation for simple tension repeated endlessly. You know, you get tense about something. All of us get tense, but when that becomes continuous and we are not able to relieve ourselves, this is what we call as stress. And that affects the body, what we in medical terms call as homeostasis, which means to maintain in equilibrium. That ability goes away, and then we cross the line between being healthy and unhealthy. So, in fact, our body has a wonderful ability to keep us healthy. It's simply wonderful because, you know, humans live in minus 20 degrees, plus 45 degrees, dry climates, humid climates, desert. You know, we have a fantastic ability to adapt. So the illness is only when this border or the line of being able to adapt goes up. The similar thing is stress. So we have inbuilt mechanisms for handling stress. Say, for example, I need to suddenly run and catch a BTS bus. I will be able to suddenly run fast, jump on the bus, you know, hold the thing and climb. Now, can I do that for next 3 hours? Can I run? May not be possible. So it is just that when this system cannot handle it anymore, then we start seeing the effects of stress. It is also not correct to say all stress is bad. No, there has to be some stress for a person to have an incentive. For example, they have tried this also, they have taken away exams completely, and you know what happens? People don't take their study seriously. Because they said, okay, exam causes stress and therefore kids should not have exams. But then what is the motivation for a person to read? There has to be some goal. So stress is necessary, and there is a very nice curve which is called as the Yerkes-Dodson. It's a bit technical, but to put it simply, initially when some minimal stress is there, the ability or the efficiency of the person goes up. But beyond a limit, when the person cannot handle it anymore, the efficiency starts going down and the person becomes incapable of coping. So stress is good as long as it is within the capacity of the individual, and as we all know, each individual is different. So for example, for somebody talking in front of this, say, group here may be extremely stressful. For somebody else that may not be stressful, but seeing a rat may be very stressful. Now, each of us have their own strengths and weaknesses. So stress just means that you have reached a situation where your body and mind cannot cope with this tension anymore. How to handle it? You have to bring it back within the body's ability to go back to handling it. You know, the body has a huge range. How do you do that? It could be medicine, say, for example, fever. If you have a fever of 105 degrees, it is very dangerous for the brain and all the other organs of the body. So you take antipyretics, you take paracetamol or something, bring it back to say 99, nothing happens to the body. Body is able to handle it. Similarly, just like this fever, anything which is stressing us, if you are able to bring it back to a level where the body is able to take over again, that's all that is needed. How do we do that for mental health conditions? It could be a combination of medicine. As Dr. Sivakumar was saying, it's not that if I'm doing yoga, I need to stop the medicine. No, that's not really the point at all. The point is, what is the best combinations of solutions for me? For one person, it may be only medicine. One person, it may be medicine plus some counseling. One person, it may be medicine plus yoga. Another person, it may be medicine, allopathic medicine plus Ayurveda. Combination are different. The doctor has to be trained to know all these approaches, and then he will be able to suggest. Now, say, let's say, take the example of yoga. Yoga also can mean so many things to so many people. You know, there is a different yoga for reducing your tummy. There is a different yoga for sleep, what is called yoga nidra. And if you are talking about healthy aging, in the yoga literature, there are specific yogic practices which have been recommended for keeping your health as you age. I'm sure Hemant would be the best on this person, and I request him to expand on this. Similarly, as Dr. Kishore said, there is a branch of Ayurveda called Rasayana Shastra, which basically deals with how to keep the person vitals normal when they are aging. So if you can take care of all these things, the rest you can leave to your body. It just needs to be brought back into that level. So maybe Hemant, you can talk about what are the yogic practices which are likely to be helpful for people who want to keep their health while they are aging.
Yes. So thank you very much, sir. When we look at yoga, it is not only involving some kind of physical or breathing practices. The real understanding of yoga is the yogic lifestyle, that it should become a continuous routine from the morning till evening. And we know that in elderly population, especially when they are retired and they don't have much to do, engaging them and some fruitful utilization of their time is very, very important. So here we actually have developed a validated yoga program where we took opinion from experts from the domain of yoga, and then found out what are the best practices for elderly to maintain their health, to preserve their health and promote healthy aging. So as per their recommendation, what they recommended was that in the morning when the elderly get up, they should start with a brisk walk. It is recommended even to prevent diabetes or hypertension or in such common NCDs, which are common in elderly, to go for a brisk walk for 40 to 45 minutes and then come back. After that, as Dr. Kishore was also saying, that in elderly population, among the five basic elements, the vata, the air and the space components start dominating and the other doshas start reducing. So to reduce that vata, it is recommended that an elderly person should massage with a warm lukewarm oil his whole body every day. So this, what it will do is, it will reduce the vata throughout the body. And at the bedtime, if they put a gentle lukewarm oil massage on their head and put two drops of the warm oil, either it can be ethyl oil, sesame oil, or coconut oil into their nostrils also, it has been found useful in improving their quality of sleep as well. So in the morning, they can do the whole body massage after coming out from the walk. They can massage their whole body, keep it for an hour, and then take a warm water shower. At the bedtime also, they can apply this lukewarm oil and give themselves a head massage. Then after that, it is recommended that they perform certain yogic practices. These yogic practices can also be done immediately after walk, or after applying the oil, they can do yoga and then take a bath. But these yogic practices should emphasize on the practices which improve their memory, concentration, and improve their quality of life and quality of sleep. So when we look at it from that aspect, then loosening of all the joints of the body, this is very simple. Like, they can start with their fingers. You have to breathe in, close them, breathe out, open them, and your mind should be on the joint that you are moving, so that you do it completely mindfully, synchronizing your body, your breath, and your mind. So whichever joint is bent, you breathe in, you release it, and you breathe out. And your attention also is on the same joint. You start with your fingers, then move your wrist, then your elbows, then your shoulder, then go to your toes, ankle joints, knee, hip joints, and then do some neck movements. And this is how you loosen all the muscles of your body. And after that, you can perform simple stretching practices. Like, you breathe in and stretch your hand up completely, breathe in and breathe out and come down. That will stretch all the muscles of your body and improve the circulation into all the muscles of your body. Then the slow breathing practices have been found to be very, very useful. In fact, elderly who have heart disease, hypertension, they should avoid actually the very fast breathing practices. So slow breathing practices, in that the alternate nostril breathing, breathing in from one side, breathing out from the other, and then the reverse. This should be done for 3 to 5 minutes. After that, they can do this humming breath and feel the massaging effect of this breath on their brain, on their body, and feel that relaxation after this. After this, mantra chanting, there have been a lot of research which has shown that regular chanting of mantra actually can prevent the memory loss. It can improve the thickness of the cortex of the brain. So some Sanskrit mantra chants, Vishnu Sahasranamam, they can chant. They can chant Gayatri mantra, Mahamrityunjay mantra, or depending on their religion, there should be a vibratory component of the sound that should come to their body, and they should focus on the vibrations of the sound. So 5 minutes of chanting. If they don't know anything, they can simply chant the sounds A, U, and Ma, and feel the vibration on these three parts of their body for 9 rounds each. So these very simple practices, joint loosening, breathing, humming, and chanting, can be incorporated into their daily living. And then after that, they should lie down in Shavasana and then just focus on their breath. They are breathing in and bulging their abdomen up, breathing out, and the abdomen goes down. Just watch the breath. Mindfully watching the breath as it comes and goes will also lead to a lot of mental relaxation. So this is a simple module that I have told that elderly should follow. Go for a 45-minute walk, come back, do joint loosening. After that, perform breathing practices, mantra chanting, and then lie down in Shavasana and perform abdominal breathing. Do this whole module, which is a 35 to 40-minute module, mindfully every day. and you will see a lot of improvement in the quality of life. Now, I would like to ask Shiv Kumar, sir. Sir, you deal with a lot of people who suffer from mental health issues, especially the elderly population. So, what are the preventive strategies which elderly can adopt, actually, which can prevent such problems? And if somebody develops, what are the things which are recommended that they should do or should not do?
Thanks, Hemant. I think apart from the physical component and the yoga component, what you have said, which also helps in cognition, which we had actually done a study in old age home, actually looking at the role of yoga for cognition as well as sleep. We had the module which was developed for yoga for elderly, that was evaluated and then it was found to be effective in improving the cognition as well as sleep. Other than that, there are several protective factors for healthy aging which are recommended. I think one is to stay connected. Now, within the context of COVID-19, that is becoming a big challenge. The social engagement is kind of, opportunities are very limited now. But I think people have to start using the technology and talk to friends. And some senior citizens, they have a challenge in kind of doing this Zoom call or maybe people can teach. I think with some practice, even we have seen senior citizens adapting to it and learning to stay connected. So some we have had people who used to go to club and then play games. Some of these activities have actually come now online. Some of the NGOs actually used to do active aging centers. Even them, they have converted these things to online in the context of COVID. So the COVID, there is only physical isolation is recommended. No social isolation is recommended. In fact, you need to be more connected now to manage the distress and to manage the stress what we are facing these things. So apart from social engagement, doing cognitively stimulating activities. So by playing some games, a traditional game, or even Sudoku, solving the crossword puzzles, or even playing something with grandchildren. So those things actually can keep your mind active. Teaching them some stories, the previous stories, or teaching them some of the old games. Those things can be very, very helpful. The only challenge is nowadays the grandchildren are more attracted to the more attractive games, mobile games. They're there in a fast-paced world. They don't give much time to senior citizens. Yes. So if they are not listening, I think they have to find their own peer group to engage themselves. So one should not kind of complain, okay, that the younger children are not paying attention or not giving enough time. I think they have to find ways how what we call as a peer support. I think this is something, there's a need for every senior citizen to help each other also. A lot of their friendships, I think that's something which needs to be encouraged, and they can be able to spend time together and then share each other whatever concerns they have and support each other. I think the peer support is something which they may be missing their morning routine walk or chatting in the groups when they all meet together because of social distancing restrictions, and rightly so in terms of taking precautions for COVID, but they should be able to call and engage them at least by telephone. Yes. So cognitive engagement, social engagement, they are very, very important for cognitive aging as well as for maintaining the cognition. And it also helps in other mental health aspects for depression, for anxiety, all those things. Also, these practices will be helpful. Apart from that, sleep, maintaining the good sleep hygiene practices. Say there are other extreme where even senior citizens get hooked up to social media and then they spend a lot of time in these technologies, and then they are also not able to have a proper sleeping rhythm. So that actually can contribute to more stress and affect the healthy aging. So sleeping in having a proper routine for sleep, sleeping in the proper time, and then giving at least 6 hours of sleep is very, very important. And they should also cut down other unhealthy practices if they're using any substances, either smoking or alcohol. Those things should be avoided because they are very much affecting the health as well as mental health, cognition as well as their mood state, everything can be affected. So with all these practices, people can actually live longer in a healthy manner. Age is just a number. And nowadays we need to look at, say, even at the life expectancy at 60 on an average is around 20 years. So we see more people above 80 also nowadays. So one should not think, okay, why should I continue these practices? Having these practices can prolong their say life in a with a good health, which will be a gift. If the same number of years are spent in poor health, that adds to a lot of distress and burden for themselves as well as for others. I think that is something, it's very important for us to do with the self-help practices to protect our health.
Definitely, sir. So now I think we should take some questions from the audience.
Yeah.
C. Nanda from Amrita University has asked, sir, in Ayurveda, how mentally ill patients were given treatment? So Nanda, yes, Dr. Kishore is there. Dr. Kishore, would you like to answer?
Yes. It was very similar to how it is now. Because in treatment of mental disorders mentioned in Charaka or Sushruta, they talk about various measures apart from the pharmacological interventions, that is panchakarma, then certain medications, either polyherbal or herbal mineral medications that were administered. Panchakarma would require admission. So how a hospital should be built has been mentioned. And in that hospital, what should be the arrangements made for people who are elderly, people who are mentally ill, these have been taken care of. And the treatment, never have they mentioned that mentally ill patients should be restrained, should be restricted, or should be limited, which used to happen, in certain time before. Such kind of things have been prohibited. Apart from that, the various theater-related activities and provisions were being made. Like Adravya Bhuta Chikitsa, there is one modality of treatment which uses certain measures to defocus a patient from a alien thought or from an undesirable behavior. Like for example, Vismaya. Vismaya is something, you show the patient or the person something which brings in some kind of surprise element. So through theater. So that was generally done through theater. So Vismapanam is, where you try to make him forget about a certain undesirable thought or behavior that is going on. Apart from that, Adhyatma Vijnana was also stressed upon. So religious facilities for religious, like yoga, meditation, or religious rituals, or bhajans and these things. So a hospital would consist of all these things. It was, the plan has been very meticulously and very beautifully explained. The design of the hospital, apart from Charaka Samhita, it is found also in Ashoka's edicts, one of the most comprehensively documented health system of ancient India. So mentally ill patients were treated pharmacologically and non-pharmacologically both. Pharmacologically, they were treated using medicines, and non-pharmacologically, they were various forms of theaters for defocusing, various forms of spiritual activities, religious activities, yoga and meditation, adhyatma they call, facilities for these were there. So all put together, it was a comprehensive approach for treatment of mental disorders. Unfortunately, that does not find mention in most of our recent textbooks, which students or school children study. They're always told that it was lunatic asylums where mentally ill patients were tied up and they were inhumanly treated. This is what they get to study. And then only later, after enactment of various ordinances, that these things improved, Britishers were there and all that. But much before that, the mental hospital and how to care a mentally ill was very beautifully documented in Ayurveda also.
There is a question in the chat that can you throw light on mindfulness for elderly? I would first like to answer this question. Basically, when you say mindfulness, we are saying that the practices that are there should be done with complete involvement of the mind, and the mind should be in the present moment. So in this, when the mindfulness component started, when the Buddha started this Anapanasati meditation, the process was very simple. You assume a very comfortable posture, sit comfortably, close your eyes, and just watch your breath. The incoming and outgoing breath. Allow the breath to follow its own pattern and just watch. This watching of the breath was called as the mindfulness meditation in the beginning, and it is still the predominant component of the mindfulness practices that are advised in various researches. Now here, when we teach this mindfulness, what we do is we include certain physical movements and certain kind of sounds, the mind resonance of the sound also into this mindfulness practice. So as I told you, whichever body part that you are moving, say for example, you are doing loosening of the wrist. So you breathe in and breathe out. Breathe in, breathe out. Your eyes closed and your whole attention is, single pointed attention is on the wrist joint, because that is the joint that you are doing. And it does not end only by doing the practice. After that, you relax. And then consciously bring your mind to your wrist joint and consciously relax it more and feel the change in your wrist joint before the practice and after the practice. If you are really sensitive, you will feel that there is a micro circulation of the capillary which has opened up and you feel lighter in that joint. Like that, you do it for all the joints of the body. And then you use certain mantras. You can start with the sound Om or any other sound that you want. But then when you are chanting, your focus is on the vibration of that sound on your body. So by doing that, you can become more mindful about the practice. I think there is another question. If possible, please share books or articles on this subject. So I'm sure we will be able to share, Shiv Kumar sir.
Yes.
Material with them about healthy aging and what we can do.
Our team will circulate the literature.
Yes.
We'll be able to send the resource materials.
Yeah.
There is also a question related to whether Ayurvedic medications and allopathic medications can be taken together, antipsychotic medications, they've asked. In general, I think from allopathic point of view, I have replied in the chat also. It is, so we need to take both the allopathic doctors or psychiatrists and the Ayurvedic physicians into confidence. They need to know that people are taking both systems of medicines, because in most situations we may be able to do that, but we need to keep a watch on interactions. If there is anything unusual happening, both of them need to talk and then consider the possibility that it may be related to any interactions and then take a decision accordingly. So if it is happening with the knowledge of both of them, it is good. Sometimes people don't tell this. They may think that, okay, it is, if I tell that I'm taking Ayurvedic drug, the allopathic physician might get upset. So on the other hand, they want complete trust in one system. So which is not the case. Actually, many of us, when we see people explore options across the systems of medicine, we can't stop them. What we need to do is also to encourage them to do it in a safe manner. So that's where a crosstalking and because the allopathic physician will not be expert on Ayurvedic drugs. We may not know what exactly it works, how exactly it works. The same thing may hold true for the Ayurvedic physician also. They may have a limited knowledge on how the particular antipsychotic works or what are the side effects. Sometimes what happens is a generalized kind of opinion is passed. Okay, Ayurveda is harmful, allopathic drugs is harmful. Then the patients take drastic steps. So which leads into a problem where they come with a big relapse and then a costly, it can even cost a life, or it can cost a significant distress and it can have a lot of negative effects for the person. So I think this is where each one has to respect each other, and we should have a trust to disclose these things
And if there is anything unusual happening, we need to consider the possibility of drug interactions, because many times there are not many systematic studies which have looked at these drug interactions, which is very, very complex from both the sides. So we need to watch out for these things.
Yes. There is a question, which are the foods that are helpful in aging gracefully? So I would like to take comment from Dr. Kishore. What are the pathyas and apathyas with regard to diet for elderly population?
Yes. Now the diet for elderly would also mean that diet which a person has to follow from the beginning, in the sense that the diet doesn't differ much when the person becomes elderly. If he is following certain food and other regimen which has been prescribed for healthy in Ayurveda, his or her aging is graceful. Now there are certain general principles. Among them, I was talking about rasayana chikitsa. In rasayana chikitsa, we have interventions wherein certain things are prepared and given, but then there are certain things which are known as nitya rasayanas. Nitya rasayanas are rasayanas which help in healthy aging, which has to be done daily. For example, Dr. Hemant was mentioning about Abhyanga. Abhyanga is a daily massage. Now, these are some tips which can be done at home. For massage, the best oil to be used is sesam oil. Sesam oil is yellenne, gingerly oil is another name for that. It's not that it is mandatory that you should use sesam, but people can use oils to which they are accustomed in that particular region. For example, in coastal Karnataka, they are accustomed to coconut oil, and that can be used. And in Rajasthan and in North India, they are accustomed to mustard oil. But mustard oil generally is, certain people experience allergies because it is little ushna. Ushna is a little heat producing, whereas coconut is a little sheeta. So this can be used. Any other oil which is home prepared can be used on the skin. Apart from that, oils need to be specifically massaged on the base, on the feet. This is very important because it keeps not only enhances longevity, but it keeps the eyesight or helps in giving a good sleep. So the massage becomes very important. Along with massage, the orifices, that is the nostrils and both ears, should be instilled with oil every day. Then even the eyes need to be instilled with ghee. So these are, this is for all the sense organs to be properly functional, to keep them properly functional, not only during the younger ages, but also during elderly. This helps in keeping all the sense organs proper. So this is one simple thing that a person, if he does daily, daily would mean it has been told as nitya rasayana, but then at least alternate day or thrice or twice a week. Another thing is a nityam kshira ghrita ashinam. Kshira is milk. Now we have a lot of questions that come whenever we speak about kshira. Kshira basically is milk, and whatever milk that we get here and what is actually healthy, there is, it's a topic for discussion and debate, one whole topic. But otherwise, cow's milk, that is desi cow's milk, is supposed to be the most healthiest milk a person can take. If currently we have seen that, there are people who maintain goshalas or desi cows and try to sell the milk from such cows, which people are using also, and ghee also is being produced. Now, there is a lot of controversy between how taking a lot of ghee is not healthy and so on. But then, if a desi cow's ghee is used, it actually does not enhance or produce dyslipidemia, because ghee per se is not the only reason. The other fats can be cut down and ghee can be taken. And when to take would be when you are hungry. Hunger, as soon as we get up early in the morning after fasting, the agni is not said to be so strong for digestion. The hunger picks up after 10, 11 or so, as the sun starts moving closer, toward the center, the agni picks up. So around 11, 12 is a time where at least 10 ml of ghee mixed with around 100 ml of milk can be taken every day. This is supposed to enhance, this is known as Nitya Rasayana. Apart from this, the easiest way, there are certain fruits like amla. Now, amla is said to be the most potent anti-aging fruit of all fruits, known as Umbilica officinalis. It has a property of, almost all diseases, because amla forms the ingredient of medications that are prepared in Ayurveda for most of the diseases. And amla, the triphala, is a component of triphala. And amla is one of the ingredients in at least 90% of all the formulations that are made. So amla can be used in North India. Certainly, I suppose they are used to eating amla. In South India, though, it is less. Now, the problem with amla is it is got only in the winter season. Yes. So in winter, the amla can be collected and it can be made into a halwa. Now, people who have diabetes or so can use very less amount of sugar or jaggery while preparation and store it. People go and buy chyavanprash, but if you want to do at home, chyavanprash is nothing but amla, which is a very important ingredient with certain other herbs together. But generally, if you boil amla and make it into a leha, a halwa, and take it daily, depending on who is taking it, if it is elderly and if he is non-diabetic, and he can take it with the good amount of sweet. Otherwise, very less of sweet can be made while making this halwa, but ghee can be used. This is one fruit that helps. Another thing, instead of using amla, or not instead, apart from using amla, the other alternative is kushmanda. Kushmanda is ash gourd. Kumbhalakai, they say Buddha Kumbhalakai. It's not the sweet pumpkin. It is actually ash gourd. And this, the juice of kushmanda every day is very good for gastritis. If 50 ml of this juice with little bit of pepper and jeera is taken in the morning, empty stomach, it not only helps in alleviating gastritis or gastrointestinal disturbances, but also helps in aging process, healthy aging. So this kushmanda, it is given, it is not only for aging, it is also very good for children. Kushmanda avaleha is one of the therapeutic formulation that is available. It has, of course, certain other herbs, depending on the indication where the kushmanda avaleha is indicated. But at home, you can grate the kushmanda and make it into halwa. And if you achieve a very good amount of paka, with the paka is the optimal amount of the consistency that is achieved by boiling with the jaggery or with ghee, it has a even this I was talking to you about amalaki avaleha, this can be stored for 3 months without any problem. Ensure that no moisture gets into the jar. So these are two things that can be, have been very specifically mentioned as anti-aging or healthy aging process. Apart from that, use of ghee and milk. Apart from that, all the vegetables, tiktashaka. Tiktashaka is bitter vegetables. Almost all the bitter vegetables are very light to digest. So your greens, karela, the lauki, that is the bottle gourd, and most of the gourds can be taken, and then bitter vegetables are best. Now currently they speak about taking millets. Millets is not so good for people who are aged, for elderly people, because millets increase vata, as Dr. Hemant was mentioning previously, that millets as a staple, taking it daily increases vata. So rice, wheat and ragi. Ragi is of course very good. So these can be used alternatively. Do not stick on to one particular kind of a grain. So it can be used alternatively. So the use of millets, use of ragi, and then it also depends on people and their place of stay. Like for example, in Uttar Karnataka, they use jowar. In North India, a lot of wheat is used. In South India, Orissa, and such places, a lot of rice is used. This is fine. But then ensure that the rice which is used, now currently the varieties of rice which are available are different. But otherwise, among the available rice varieties, the best is one which is called as Navara. This is available in Kerala. If you go to Dakshina Kannada, there is red rice which is used. This red rice is also known as boiled rice. Now, these two are rice varieties which are very healthy, very light to digest. They say good for good for people who have problems with digestion. In fact, red rice is used even in families outside coastal Karnataka when the person is suffering from any kind of disease like infections or gastrointestinal disturbances, because this is very light to digest and doesn't cause problems, instead of white rice. So these are some small tips which can be used for healthy aging at home. This is apart from all the other advices which Dr. Shiv Kumar, Dr. Shivram, Dr. Hemant was saying. But please visit any Ayurveda physician for a detailed because it's not under my purview that I tell you certain things, but we have done certain studies on geriatric population. We have tried with Chyavanprash, which has been prepared Brahma Rasayana, on people, and we have seen that there was a significant improvement in the PGI memory scale, physical endurance, and WHO quality of life BREF. This was seen in 3-month period. So these kind of things, please do not try it by buying on the counter from any medical shops. Please take it under the supervision of a Ayurveda doctor. But otherwise, at home, these are the things which I can say and easily implementable. Also, another important thing is use such as spices that help in digestion and metabolism. The most useful ones are cumin, jeera, om, that is ajwain, dhania, which is coriander seeds, some amount of turmeric, and ginger and pepper. Now, these are non-harmful spices, except ginger. Be careful while using ginger. Do not use it daily because you might end up getting gastritis. Ginger has to be used in a lesser quantity. Ginger and pepper both have to be used in a lesser quantity. But the other ones like jeera, ajwain, and these things have to, have very good effect if taken. The best way to take it is with buttermilk. Buttermilk, people add water to curds, make it diluted and drink it. That is not at all buttermilk. It is actually counterproductive. Secondly, the curds which is used should not be sour at all. If sour curds is used, it is counterproductive. Instead of helping GIT, it will worsen the symptoms. So two things very important. Buttermilk has to be made by friction. Use either mixi or a churner, which is generally used in traditional families, or a mixer can be used. Or you can just put it in a plastic bottle and shake it vigorously for 5 minutes. The butter starts flowing out. So if the curd is not subjected to friction, it is not at all buttermilk. Please don't be under that impression. Dilute curds is never a buttermilk. So buttermilk can be added with the jeera or ajwain or dhania. This over a long period of time is very good for gastrointestinal tract. And if taken, try to avoid taking this at night. It can be taken when sun is there. And this common issues of gastritis, common issues of digestive problems in elderly age group can be addressed very easily. Constipation, all these can be addressed very easily by taking buttermilk daily with these spices. So these are some tips that might be useful on a daily basis for an elderly population. It's not only that only elderly population should take, this should be taken by everyone, so that their GIT health, their metabolic health, all can be maintained properly.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kishore, and I am really thankful to all the panelists here for joining. Summarizing what has been discussed in the last 1 hour, we understand that mental health is a very, very important component towards healthy aging, and to manage that, it is imperative that all the systems, whatever best that they have to offer, should come together. And then in that, the modern medicine provides the aspects that is recommended, from the psychological support and the medications that are required. Also, Dr. Shivkumar emphasized on the value of social connect in today's time. He also encouraged elderly to get more connected socially, play some games, and remain mentally active. Shivram sir told us about the importance of mental health. He also suggested us some useful practices to tackle stress in this situation. He emphasized on the use of yogic and mindfulness based practices. Dr. Kishore told us about the what kind of lifestyle should be followed by an elderly person towards healthy aging. He said that we should use oil massages, we should use certain kind of food items, avoid certain kind of food items, and also we should follow the biorhythms, the particular time of eating. That should be emphasized from the Ayurveda perspective. And then from the yoga perspective, a 45 minute of brisk walk, loosening of all the joints of the body, slow breathing practices of alternate nostril breathing and the humming breath, and then certain kind of mantra chanting should be emphasized. So with this, we come towards the conclusion of this panel discussion. There are some more questions which we could not take now, but definitely we will remain in touch with you and you can mail them to us. Thank you very much. I think you should unmute.
Thanks,
sir.
Yeah, yes. Thanks, Hemant. Cecil, we can actually end the session.
Yes, thank you very much, the panelists, for a very informative session. And special thanks to the moderator for keeping it very interactive and for very practical tips that you have given us, sir. We really appreciate the time that you have given for the session. And the participants have also been quite active in asking questions appropriately. So we thank you all. We'll get back in touch with you in terms of some of you have asked for material on the same, on the interdisciplinary approach. We'll circulate it to you. The workshop I have announced in the beginning, but for people who joined in later, the workshop will begin on 12th of October. That's from Monday onwards. We have split you into 5 batches. We'll get in touch with the first batch initially. If we've not written to you by the next 2 days, and you are not in the first batch, some people have requested to be in the first batch. We'll consider that. And the certificates for the previous session will be circulated within this week. And for the coming session, you kindly fill the feedback form. We'll send it to you as soon as possible. There's been a little technical delay from issue with our end. That's why there's a slight delay. Kindly bear with us. And I thank you. Thank all the participants in Zoom as well as on YouTube for joining us today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Vananda.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks, Shiram.
Thank you.